I'd like to get started. It is a great pleasure for me to introduce Jordi Bascompte. Jordi is a professor at, and I will mangle my Spanish, Estación Biológica de Doñana, which is a center of the Spanish Research Council. Jordi got his, it's in Sevilla, which is a wonderful city, a very old and famous city. Jordi got his PhD at the University of Barcelona, working with Ricardo Soleil, and he did postdoctoral research at the southern part of the state at Irvine, and then following that at NC's in Santa Barbara. But this is the first time he's been at Davis. And he's done really pioneering work focusing on the use of ideas from networks. He's done work on mutualism. He's done work on metapopulations. Most of his work has been primarily theoretical, but he does get out into the field, not too much, he says. It can be dangerous, and it's also very difficult. He's happy to be here. He's also won numerous awards, including the Spanish National Research Award in Environmental Sciences. He was a winner of the Mercer Award from the Ecological Society of America and a European Young Investigator Award. He's the Ideas and Perspectives editor at Ecology Letters and is on the board of reviewing editors for Science. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Jordi, who'll be talking to us on plant-animal mutualistic networks, the architecture of biodiversity.
Thanks so much, Alan. Thanks so much for that introduction, especially for inviting me being here. It's really a pleasure to be part of this now long tradition of very distinguished speakers that have been talking here today. And it's been lots of fun these last couple of days meeting so many old friends such as Alan and Marcel Holiak and many others, but also meeting some new bright young ecologists. It's been really, really nice. And even the weather has been quite nice, so I cannot complain. It's been really lots of fun. So today I'm happy to be able to talk here today. And what I'll try to do is summarize the sort of work that in the last now more than 10 years, my colleagues and I have been putting together on trying to understand how mutualisms are organized in species-rich communities and what are the implications for our understanding of the coevolutionary process and the robustness of these communities. If we think about biodiversity, that would probably be the sort of iconic image that it would come to our mind, a picture with hundreds of insects in a museum. However, that picture is not capturing an equally important component of biodiversity, that is the way these species interact. And that's going to be what I'm going to be focusing on today, species interactions. Interactions such as the one here in the picture where you see this toucan bird in the Brazilian rainforest eating a fruit of that particular plant species. That's an interaction of mutual benefit because both players got a reward from the interaction. On one hand, the bird eats some food. On the other hand, the plant finds a way for its genes to be spread over the landscape. So both species get a benefit from that interaction. These sort of mutually beneficial interactions are by no means new in ecology because, as with many other things in ecology and evolutionary biology, Darwin himself started working on that particular type of interactions. 150 years now ago, he published this book where he focused on the way orchids and their insect pollinators were matching each other. And from then, we've learned that these mutually beneficial interactions have played a major role in the generation of biodiversity across the history of Earth, are a very important component in our understanding of why there are so many species on Earth. However, the majority of this work so far have focusing on only one couple of species, such as, for example, this type of picture, which is similar to many others that you can see in the covers of textbooks. In this case, it's a moth with a very, very long tongue, and the length of the tongue is pretty much the same than the length of the corolla of the flower that is pollinating in these pictures. Actually, Darwin knew about that orchid in Madagascar. Nobody knew about that species at the time, and Darwin made a prediction about how this moth would be in a very nice example of the predictive power of evolutionary theories. So that would be the sort of systems that evolutionary biologists have been working on in the last 100, almost 150 years. Even when you find these sort of systems in the field, they are more the exception than the general rule, because oftentimes this mutualism happens in species-rich communities. And yet we knew almost nothing about how these mutualisms are organized in such species-rich communities. And yet understanding that is very important in starting to understand how coevolution shapes these communities and originates these communities and how are gonna be responding to perturbation. So 10 years ago, with my colleagues Pedro Jordano in Spain and Jens Olesen in Denmark, we start trying to figure out how could we tackle mutualism at the community level. And that, at that point, we decided to borrow a tool that was becoming very popular. It was network theory. In a network like this one, you have a set of nodes and a set of links. In our particular case, that's a way of representing one particular mutualistic community. In this case, each green node represents a plant species, such as the common yew in the picture, and each yellow node represents an animal species, such as the red wing in here. So there's a link between the animal and the plant. If the former, it's a seed disperser in this case, or a pollinator of the plant. So that would be a way to characterize the complexity of one of those communities. Already you can acknowledge that that's a very complicated object, so it's not a big surprise that so far people were breaking down these sort of systems, isolating a couple of elements, and studying these elements in isolation. The problem is that in the process, we oftentimes forgot how to go back to the entire community. And the problem is that an increasing number of questions we are facing right now have to do or are posed at the level of the entire network. So essentially what we try to do then is to borrow this tool. And secondly, we wanted to generalize about how these communities are organized, not one particular community, let's say, in Doñana, south of Spain, or in the Arctic, but in general, what was common, if something, across all these communities. Therefore, with that tool, we follow by building a very large data set, here summarized. Each dot represents the spatial location of one of these communities, for which we were able to build a network like the one we've seen in the previous slide. That's the first stage of our research, but already I like you to realize that it's an incredible amount of work, and the credit goes to dozens of field ecologists that for decades have been compiling very patiently these sort of systems. So now with this type of tool, a network, that if you want, it's a kind of microscope to try to find order across this apparent entangled bank of interactions and species, and with this kind of data set that it's going to allow us to look for invariant patterns in how these communities are organized, I'll try to answer three questions. The first one would be trying to describe the architecture of these networks. Secondly, and more importantly, the idea would be trying to see to what degree understanding the structure of these networks is going to inform us on how robust are these networks to the random loss of species, the random extinction of species? And secondly, what's the implication of network structure for the number of species that can coexist? That is to say, to what degree network structure is important for understanding the size of these communities to begin with? And finally, I'll end up by briefly saying something about the latest part of our research that goes, once we've described these patterns at the entire network, going back to the level of the individual players, going back to the level of the individual species, and trying to see to what degree different species contribute in different ways to these overall patterns of structure and these overall patterns of robustness. So let's start about looking at what these networks look like, describing the architecture of these networks, and I'm going to be very, very brief here, but essentially the idea is trying to see how these interactions between plants and animals are organized and whether this way of organization is different to what we would expect out of chance. And in particular here I'm going to be using a cartoon that would be a matrix where I'm ranking the number each plant species as rows, each animal species as columns. In this cartoon, a white square would represent that plant number 10 and animal number 1 interact. They've been observed in the field interacting. And essentially, a nested matrix such as this in here is characterized because specialists, such as plant number 10, interact with a subset of species or with a number of species that are contained in the larger subset of species interacting with the most generalist species. That is to say, if we go from the most specialist to the most generalist, we see that interaction contained in this set, which in turn is contained in this one, and so on, as in Chinese boxes, small boxes, within medium-sized boxes, within larger boxes. That's a very particular way of addressing these interactions. We could have the same number of animals, the same number of plants, the same number of interactions, but distributed in different ways. So, as you can see here, that would be an example of one real network, exactly the same you've seen in previous slide. The tendency of these networks is to be organized in this nested pattern. Out of all the possibilities, we see a pattern that, although I'm only showing an example in here, is found repeatedly across different networks. Doesn't matter the size of this network, doesn't matter if they come from a Mediterranean community, an Arctic community, a tropical one, even when the identity of a species changed quite a lot from a place to another, we still are able to find some common pattern at the level of the entire network. That would be an example of the sort of patterns we can see in this type of networks. Now, the second stage of our research, once we've described what these networks look like, is trying to figure out if there's an implication for our understanding of the dynamics of these networks. And essentially here, what people have been doing, even before us, have been relying in computer simulations because it's very, very difficult having real temporal data from this sort of system. So essentially, the approach we and others have taken is starting with a real network such as this one and proceeding by removing, in this case, the most specialist plant species, the second most specialist plant species, the third one, the fourth one, and so on, and looking at which point of removing species the network collapses, in the sense that if now you remove an additional species, the network gets broken into different sets, into different sub-networks. So the idea is that depending on how these interactions are organized, these communities are going to stand higher values of perturbation than others. And essentially, the take-home message of these preliminary studies would be that that particular nested structure that we've described is the one that makes these communities more robust if the specialists are the ones with a higher risk of extinction. If that's the case, which seems quite reasonable because specialists tend to be less abundant species and therefore more fluctuating ones and with a higher risk of extinction, if that's the case, other things being equal, that particular nested structure is going to allow these communities to be more robust. However, the robustness of these communities relies very much on a few super generalist of species. If those super generalist species are driven extinct, then the network falls apart really, really fast. So that would be like a preliminary stage. So far, that's a very, there's lots of simplifications in here. There's lots of additional details we could start bringing back. But at the very least, it's a first stage that allows us to see that there's a clear relationship between network architecture and the robustness of this network. However, so far, people have been looking at how many species disappear, how fast the network collapses, but treating all species likewise, like if they were similar. Of course, this is not the case. And of course, if we want to make a step further into understanding how the functional diversity, the taxonomic diversity of these communities is going to be eroded as more species are driven extinct, we have now to go back to these networks and to add the name tags, if you want, of each one of those species. So again, I'm going to start with a network. In this case, the size of the node is proportional to its number of links for visualization purposes. And what we did in here, it's now adding a new layer of information. In particular, we were superposing the phylogeny of the plants and the phylogeny of the animals. And the idea was, again, borrowing a very interesting set of tools that evolutionary biologists had been using for probably 20 years at the time, that is named the comparative method or phylogenetically independent contrast. And the idea is trying to see to what degree the evolutionary history of a species is important when we want to understand a particular trait. In particular, in here, the idea is trying to see if two species that are very close in the phylogeny, these two species only branch quite early in evolutionary terms, the idea is if species that are close in the phylogeny are also close in terms of their position in the network of interactions. For example, if phylogenetically similar species tend to have a similar number of interactions, tend to interact with the same subset of species. And then to do that, we took advantage of the expertise of a former postdoc of mine, Enrico Resende, who had just graduated from UC Riverside with Ted Garland, and they were mastering these sort of tools, this phylogenetical independent contrast, and therefore it was a great occasion to import these tools to understanding the generation of these network patterns. So to summarize these results, this slide here, what I'm doing in here, each symbol would represent a community. Now we are splitting communities from the point of view of plants as the circles and animals as the squares. And the idea is that for each one of these communities, what we are doing is trying to see to what degree phylogeny matters when understanding network patterns. And in particular, what we are doing is comparing a matrix of phylogenetic similarity that is telling us two given species how close are in the phylogeny with a matrix of ecological similarity. For example, two species are ecologically very similar if they tend to be pollinated by the same subset of pollinators. So if you compare these two matrices by using a mantle test, we can see if there's a significant correlation. And a significant correlation is represented as a field symbol in here. So roughly speaking, one out of two communities, 50% of these communities, have a significant correlation. That means that in half of these communities, phylogeny really matters. If we want to understand current patterns of network structure, we have to understand past evolutionary history of the plants and the animals that constitute these networks. Those results, I think, are important for two reasons. One, to begin with, because they start telling us what sort of mechanisms may explain these patterns, and therefore giving us an information about the generation of these networks, but also because can be useful now if we go back to these simulation experiments to see how phylogenetic diversity is going to decline as more species go extinct. So now I'm going back to these simulations as before, and imagine we perform these simulations, we remove an additional species, and let's assume that 10 additional species go co-extinct, because when species run out of resources, we assume they cannot live, and therefore we assume they go co-extinct. Up to now, we were just counting how many species go co-extinct, but now what we can see is how are they distributed across the phylogeny. If there was no phylogenetic signal, if phylogeny was independent of these network patterns, we could find something like that. Imagine that we now represent these species that go co-extinct as each one of these white dots. Those would be randomly sampled from the phylogeny. But as it is that we may be losing 10 species, situation would be not that bad in evolutionary terms, because in some cases that would be like pruning only the leaves of that evolutionary tree. Just losing a few, in evolutionary terms, a few years of shared evolutionary history. However, that's not what happens. Because of that phylogenetic signal, the idea is that if several species go co-extinct, because they tend to rely on the same resources, right, the species that tend to rely on the same resources are phylogenetically linked, that means that when 10 species disappear, they tend to be clustered across the phylogeny. That's a consequence of finding a phylogenetic signal. Species close in the phylogeny share the same resources. When those resources disappear, the species going co-extinct are obviously close in the phylogeny. So the situation is much worse than before, because not only we can be witnessing the extinction of, let's say, 10 species, but we can be witnessing the disappearance of entire branches of evolutionary history. We can see the extinction of millions of years of evolutionary history, and of course, some of the traits that make unique this source of species in terms of, for example, how they cope with nutrients and with light in the case of plants. And in particular, we are losing potential for adaptation to new scenarios. And that's really bad in the context of global change. So far, therefore, we've briefly described the structure of these networks. We've seen that this structure informs us on how robust they are, and in particular, that make them more stable to the random extinction of species. But because of that phylogenetical signal, the rate at which taxonomic information is lost is faster than what we would expect in the absence of that phylogenetic signal. Now I'm going to be moving to the second stage and trying to see to what degree, so far we've looking given a network, how robust is this going to be. Now I'll try to address the question of to what degree understanding these network patterns is important to understanding how big these networks are to begin with, how many species they can support. And now to do that, I'm going to shift gears, and I'm going to use a slightly different approach. And in particular, now I'm going to be using theory and some mathematical models that are a simplistic description of the dynamics of these mutualistic communities. It's not important for you to look at the details, but only at the general idea. And I'll try to walk you across those general things. In particular, those models are describing at what rate the abundance of one particular plant, number I, changes through time. And that depends on three main factors. On one hand, it depends on an intrinsic growth rate, so different plant species, given a set of sunlight and water and nutrients, are going to grow, and some are going to grow faster than others. That's that particular first term. Secondly, there's a negative term, and this encapsulates the fact that different plants are competing for these shared resources, so that's a negative term. If other plants are very abundant, that's going to decrease the growth of plant number I. And finally, there's a positive term that encapsulates the effect of these mutualists. Other things being equal, the larger the number of mutualisms that work with me, the better it's going to be for me, so the faster I'm going to be growing. So that's a very general model, but hopefully it touches the basic ingredients that play a major role in how these communities are organized. That would be one example of many others that ecologists have been using when trying to describe communities at the theoretical level. The problem with these models is that there's always a trade-off. You either work with a model for one or two species and you are able to find analytical results, or you try to work with models at the entire community, but oftentimes you can only write down analytical results if you treat them as what physicists would call a mean field approach, if you assume that all plants interact with all animals. But of course, we didn't want to do that. What we wanted to do is to import the particular structure of these networks and try to see what that structure affects. So, joining forces with a group of theoretical physicists back in Spain, we're able to work with this type of systems, still to describe the particular structure of the networks we observe, exactly what plant interacts with what animal, and being able to solve analytically those equations. And as an example, this would be the sort of equations that we can write down. Again, results or details are not really important. Essentially, what I'm writing here is what's the competition between plan I and plan J. And that depends on a series of factors which are not relevant in here, but in particular, I like you to focus on what we have in here. That would be the number of interactions of plan I, the number of interactions of plan J, and that would be the number of shared interactions between plan I and J. Now, if you remember, that's exactly the definition of a nested matrix. Because in particular, in a nested matrix, like for example, if we are comparing yellow plan and orange plan, the number of shared interactions with that insect and with this second insect, it's maximized. So if the matrix is nested, that term in here, it's maximized, and because there's a negative term, that decreases competition between these two plant species. So actually, analytically, we can find a link, we can find a bridge between the topology of these networks, their architecture, and some meaningful property of the dynamics of these sort of systems. This is for only two species, but this can be generalized, and by doing some algebra, one can write down that equation that tells you what's the average competition, effective competition between two any plant species, and that depends on a single number, that for the ones of you more inclined towards math, that would be the leading eigenvalue of this matrix. If you are not so inclined about math, the only relevant thing is that that's a value that depends on how these interactions are organized. If now we were reorganizing this matrix in different ways, we would have different values that in turn would determine this average competition. And by writing a little bit more of algebra, finally, we can come down with this equation. What this equation is doing is writing or predicting what's the increase in number of species as opposed as a baseline of a system without mutualisms that these systems can support. And that increase in number of species is a function of this average competition, which in turn is a function of the way these networks are organized. Therefore, the take-home message would be that in these simple models, other things being equal, the higher nestedness is, the lower interspecific competition, and therefore the maximum the number of species that can stably coexist in these communities. Therefore, that's quite interesting, again, because we've been able to find a direct relationship from the topology, which is like taking a snapshot, a picture of these communities, and some meaningful property of how these networks change through time. However, that's a theoretical result, and we don't know to what degree that increase in biodiversity is meaningful, because that increase depends very much on the range of values of nestedness we observe in nature. To get a better idea of that, we're going to now be plugging these analytical predictions with the real networks in our data set. And you can see the result in here. Each dot represents a community. Essentially, the output of the model for that particular community with exactly the same number of plant species, the same number of animal species, and the interactions between both sets. And as you can see here, for the range of values of nestedness that we observe in nature, there's a considerable variability in the predicted number of species. So other things being equal, that range of values of nestedness can actually be important when understanding differences in number of species coexisting in different communities. So far, therefore, not only the structure of these networks is important in understanding how robust they're going to be, but it's also important in understanding how many species they can support. And because there's this clear link, that's the reason we oftentimes refer to this term of the architecture of biodiversity, because clearly the way these interactions, these mutualistic interactions are organized, it's a way that maximizes the number of species that can coexist. Once we've seen that relationship between network structure and network robustness and size, we were looking at the network level. To begin with, I'm gonna finally gonna move to what are the roles of different species in creating these network patterns, in creating these patterns of coexistence. And the idea is quite easy. The idea I'm gonna be doing here, illustrated in these cartoons, for each animal species, let's say the animal whose interactions are highlighted in orange here, I'm gonna be trying to estimate what is the contribution of this animal to these overall network patterns, in particular to this nested pattern. And a way to do that is comparing the value of nestedness for that community, the observed community, with a population, with the values of nestedness for a population of communities at which I randomly shuffle the interactions of that animal. The higher the difference between nestedness in these two sets, the higher the contribution of the animal to the overall nestedness of the community. Essentially, we are trying to quantify to what degree the interactions of that particular animals are organized in the way that increases, that tends to maximize the overall nestedness of the community. We can now compute that from our data sets, and that would be what you can see if you do that for the entire data set of plants. Here we are plotting the individual nestedness contribution, and here the relative frequency across all the communities. Essentially, what you can see is that there's a quite heterogeneous distribution. While a few species contribute very little to this overall network architecture, there's some species that have a much stronger contribution. There's quite a variability in the contribution of each species to these patterns we've been describing across this talk. Now, because there's this variability, the next question would be, to what degree species that contribute the most to this, if you want, common good of network robustness and network size, are also the species that get the best, the major benefit from that particular network structure. And to do that, again, we have to rely on simulations. And what we are doing is writing this model of how these communities evolve through time, using, again, real mutualistic networks. And we run these models through time. And at the end, a few species go extinct. Other species survive by the end of our simulations. And now we are going to be comparing the contribution of nestedness of the species that survive with those of the species that go extinct. And the results are plotted in here. This is a little bit difficult graph, so let me walk you across that. What I'm doing here is, both for plants and for pollinators, I'm plotting in this side here the individual contribution of the species that go extinct. And in here I'm plotting the individual contribution of species that survive. That would be like a logistic regression. And what this is telling us is that, on average, there's a tendency for the species that most contribute to nestedness to be the ones that have a higher probability of going extinct. So the species, ironically, the species that have the stronger contribution towards that patterns of network structure that are the ones maximizing overall coexistence, ironically, are the ones with a higher risk of going extinct. So far, since we have no temporal data, that's based on simulations. And of course, one can think to what extent those results depend on the details of the simulations, of the assumptions that we are putting when we are writing down that set of differential equations. We were lucky enough that in the last few years there's been some interest from different fields into these sort of results. So a few papers here, you find only a few examples from economy, from socioeconomic systems, that to some extent they were trying to use the same type of approach to understanding how mutualism, how cooperation is organized in different type of systems. And in particular, we start joining forces from a group at Northwestern University, led by Sergei Saavedra, now a postdoc in my lab, and Brian Uzzi, that what they were working is in a particular example of socioeconomic system, an example of the garment industry in New York City. Essentially, that's a system also described by a bipartite network, where on one hand you have a set of nodes, in this case companies, that produce a good, textile for example, and then a set of other nodes that buy that product to make, for example, shirts or t-shirts or whatever. So again, that's a system, although the nature of the system is very different than the ecological ones, it also encapsulates this balance between competition and facilitation. And therefore, it can be described with this sort of networks, and some of these ideas, hopefully, can be applied here. So essentially, what we were doing in the last year, a couple of years, was trying to look at that particular type of system for which they have wonderful temporal data. So in here, you know the companies, which ones stay in business every year, which ones run out of business. It's like going extinct every year. And therefore, you can repeat the same kind of calculations, but not anymore from a simulation based on a particular model, but from the real data. And that's the result in here, before, as we've seen in the previous slide. And here you have the same for designers and contractors. And again, regardless of the different nature of those systems, probably because what is relevant in here is how this balance between facilitation and competition is articulated, we find exactly the same pattern. The companies that have the highest contribution to this common good are ironically the ones with higher risk of extinction. As the old song said, only the young die. Oh no, only the good young die young. It's the jet lag. Anyway, so that's quite of an ironic result. And if you start realizing, it's very much embedded into this tragedy of commons that pervades all sorts of social dilemmas when you have a social of agents that use a common resource. And there's always this tension between the individual benefit and the global benefit. It's a way to look at the tragedy of the commons, but from a network perspective. And in particular, this is very preliminary results, but is pointing out towards a situation where, if this is confirmed, you could be able, in principle, to make predictions about what can be the influence of, let's say, an invasive species that arrives to a new ecosystem or a new company that enters this economic system. And even when there's lots of simplifications in here, other things being equal, that can start guiding us our understanding of the different roles of different agents. And for example, in the socioeconomic realm, that can be interesting because if we are able to identify agents, nodes, companies, whatever, that have a higher contribution to a common good, perhaps we can start developing policies that try to support these nodes that are key players in maintaining these patterns of network structure. So, therefore, not only these networks have particular values of structure that make them more robust in face of random extinctions and made them higher in terms of supporting species, but there's a very interesting now tension between those global patterns and the roles played by different species. When species or nodes enter in these networks, there's a tension between their individual welfare and the welfare of the entire system. And I'm going to stop in here, and I like to wrap up this talk. And in the same way that I start this talk with that picture of a museum displaying this iconic image of biodiversity in terms of number of species, I like to stop my talk, to finish my talk, with a picture that I think encapsulates very well the take-home message of my talk. And in this case, it's not going to be a picture coming from biology, but a picture coming from art. This is a beautiful example of one of the mobiles of Alexander Calder. It doesn't matter if you've never seen this one in particular, but immediately you recognize this is a piece of work by Alexander Calder, because all these mobiles have this very particular style. And in the same way that we understand, it's easy to understand that that style has more to do with just the shape of those nodes, because it has more to do with how these nodes, how these elements are interconnected. In the same way, we have to embrace the notion that there's more to biodiversity than just a number of species. Species form also networks, and these networks have also a common style that we see across communities, and understanding, describing that particular style or that particular architecture may be very relevant, because we've started to learn that this particular architecture can inform us about how robust these networks are, how big these networks are going to be, and therefore that can be quite interesting if we want to face the big challenges we are facing right now and will be facing in the next coming years about not only how one particular species is going to respond to global change, but how entire communities and the services they provide, for example, in here, the service of pollination, are going to respond to global change. And finally, I'm going to stop with a single slide that encapsulates or describes the fact that, as you've realized, that's a truly collaborative work. We've been trying to add different layers of information. We've been starting from very detailed field work. We've been adding those simulations. We've been adding evolutionary information. We've been adding these analytical treatments. And of course, it's very difficult to master all of these approaches. The easiest way is to collaborate with people. So I want to end up acknowledging all my collaborators, the usual suspects, in particular my good friends Pedro Jordano and Jens Olesen, with whom we start working 10 to 12 years ago about mutualistic networks, a group of really, really excellent graduate students and postdocs, Forma and Karen in my lab, and other co-authors across the world. It's really an excellent group of people, and I've been very lucky to have the chance to work with them and to have fun with them and to learn from them. And I think I'll stop here. Thanks so much. That's a great suggestion. It's a great example. That's a particular case study, but I think you can find lots of systems where thinking globally, thinking systemically, may be very important if we want to understand really how they work. I think that's something that we are sharing both ecologists and economists these days. I mean, systemic risk is like a keyword these days, but only in the last four years, right? I think that's very important. I think you are totally right. Sometimes we tend to isolate these companies or these species, but if we think in terms of networks or globally, this is just a way to think globally, right? I think we can start understanding much better how these systems work.
So is the trade-off between the individual contribution to network robustness and individual vulnerability, is that inherent to the network structure, or is it a consequence of how these networks have evolved in the particular structure we see in these ecological or economic networks?
That's a very good question, for which I'm afraid we have no an answer. So it's much easier to describe these patterns, as we've done here so far, than trying to understand what's the mechanism leading to these patterns. So honestly, we do not have an answer right now. However, we can speculate a little bit, and because we've seen that there's phylogenetic signal, one way for me to understand those patterns would be that species that are more constrained to have their interactions in a unique way, the way maximizing nestedness, have probably less flexibility in terms of benefiting from the best players, as opposed species that interact in lots of different ways can, at a given situation, get the largest reward from a particular player. So that would be a way to try to explain that, but it's just a guess. Unfortunately, we still do not have that. And even when we are adding these layers, it's very difficult, because knowing there's a phylogenetic signal, it's very important, I think, because it kind of gives you that evolutionary perspective. But still, it's a correlation. So it's very difficult from that correlation, as in general is the case, trying to disentangle causality. But I think is a fascinating question, and hopefully in the next few years we'll know a bit about it. Probably working with particular experimental systems where we can really manipulate the dynamics or the process. Hopefully we can know something in the near future.
How relevant is the breaking apart of a network into subcomponents compared to the loss of individual nodes?
I didn't hear the first part of the question. Can you repeat, please?
Sorry. How relevant is the breaking apart of a network into subcomponents, which I take to be implicit in robustness, compared to just the robustness to the loss of individual nodes?
Yes, I think both elements are relevant. Sometimes people focus on the breakdown of the networks because partly is because of a historical reason. The very first people using this sort of node deletion experiments were working with the internet, another example of very complex network. And the internet, it's very relevant to see to what degree the random failure of computers or the directed attack by hackers of some servers can break down the network in terms of having isolated pieces. In the context of the internet, of course, that's very relevant because it would mean that if we are in a particular cluster, still we can email each other, but we cannot email anymore somebody from another cluster, right? In terms of ecosystems, I think that could be relevant because it would tell us to what degree we are losing the interconnectivity of the systems and therefore the multiple influences of different species. This being said, however, it's also relevant the fact that you are losing species. One thing is very much related to another one.
So some studies have shown that network observations can be dependent on sampling frequency and intensities.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that the networks you've been studying have been sampled at scales that are kind of relevant to ecological or evolutionary patterns?
Mm-hmm.
And if not, do you think there are any of your results that will be changed if you had maybe more data?
Exactly. Very good question. Again, that's a question that it's similar to the question that people were facing a few years ago in terms of studies of species richness. Like, for example, you go to the field, you start sampling individuals, and you come out with a number of species, or how this number of species change across the landscape. In the same way that there are challenges related to sampling, this happened also with the interactions. Right now, in the last couple of years, this has been of a concern, and we've been using the same sort of tools that had been proposed, for example, by Nick Gotelli, in terms of species richness inventories, that are rarefaction curves. That essentially means that, okay, we have some of these networks, we have been sampling them for long enough or across a large enough area. What we can be plotting is how many of these interactions have been identified by just sampling, let's say, 3 days, 6 days, 9 days, and so on. And then by looking at how this curve levels off and enters a plateau, you can determine to what extent the spatial scale of that network or the number of hours you've been sampling is good enough. And in a few cases, you can prove, and now this has been proven, that the level of detail is good enough in terms of describing those patterns. Of course, that changes across networks. When you work with large data sets, that means that some of these communities are compiled in a much more accurate way or with a larger effect. But at the very least, for a few of those communities, sampling effort is good enough in terms of describing the number of interactions and these particular patterns. And if you are interested, there's a couple of papers. One was published in 2007, led by a student, a former student in Oslo, in Journal of Ecology. So using experimental plots, he was just plotting how nestedness, for example, but also number of species, number of interactions change as the number of these sampling plots increased. And the second paper that comes to my mind is a paper led by Jens Olesen, published last year in the, I think, in the Proceedings of the Royal Society, where you are using for the first time, I think, these rarefaction curves in the context of these networks. Andy.
I think of a major issue in network theory in general is the notion that the connections themselves can often change, and often change adaptively. So in a human social network, if you use that to analyze epidemiology, you should account for the fact that when people get sick, other people avoid them, or you know, there's changes in who's connected to who. And for pollinators or frugivores or whatever, I think we do know that they can shift, you know, who they're actually visiting, depending on all sorts of things. They might even follow optimal diet theory or something like that. So what's the state of the field here in looking at how these the network connections actually change and how that might compensate for a lot of the things you're talking about?
Yeah, you are totally right in that. And right now there's been at least a couple of papers addressing that. I mean, as always, you start with a simple scenario, and little by little, you start adding complexity. So now there's been, for example, a couple of years ago, there's a paper in Ecology Letters by a Swiss guy, I forgot his last name, and what they were doing is exactly what you are describing, allowing this trophic flexibility, doing the similar type of simulations, but at the point a species runs out of interactions, there's a probability for these species to link to other ones. And there's a more recent review, also in Ecology Letters, led by the first author is a Chilean young student, Fernanda Valdovinos, that starts discussing the few examples of simulation papers where you do that. But the first one was in the context of food webs by Mikio Kondo, a Japanese guy. So you are totally right, this happens in nature, and right now there's been a couple of papers trying to add that component into these sort of systems. The take-home message is that other things being equal, of course, that makes these networks a little bit more robust. But hopefully, the relationship between network structure and the collapse is still maintained. Only thing that the point at which they collapse is a little bit higher, but still that influence of network is still there.
How about just quickly the relationship between that issue and when invaders come in? So non-natives come in, how does the whole network structure even shift for new players coming in?
That's a very nice question. And again, I'm very happy to see that lots of bright people have been pushing these ideas in new directions. And in particular, there are several groups around that have been using this sort of approach to address things related to biological invasions. I would single out three people, which I think are doing great stuff in that lines. One would be an Argentinian ecologist, Marcelo Aizen, who published a beautiful paper in PLOS Biology a few years ago. And if you are interested, I can give you the details later on. It's a paper in PLOS Biology. A second would be a colleague of mine in my institute, Montse Vila, who also works with invasive species. And the third example would be Jem Memot in UK. So these people and others, but in particular these ones I'm more familiar with, they are using this network perspective to understand invasive species at the community level. And in particular, the preliminary results suggest that the topology of these networks make it, other things being equal, of course, make it easier the attachment of an invasive species to these networks, but at the same time, buffer the consequence of this invasion, for example, from the point of view of pollen load, from the point of view of what's the consequence for a local species in terms of the amount of pollen that it's not going to arrive just because pollinators are now going to visit the new species. It seems that these three different groups, interestingly enough, I was quite happy because from different approaches, they come out exactly with the same set of results. Again, this topology facilitates the invasion of species, but once the invasive is already present in the community, buffers the consequences. Alan.
So this sort of builds on a
couple of questions have been asked is what role would be played, and you could look at this in the dynamic model at the end, what role is played by different strengths of interactions rather than assuming that the nodes are, that there's just a connection or not?
That's a very good question. I totally agree with you. That's quite, I think I had a slide, let me think. I'll show you a slide because unfortunately in a talk one has to select the amount of information, but let me see if I have it here. I think I have. Yes, that would be the slide. You are totally right. So in that particular paper in 2006, what we were looking is exactly at what you are suggesting. Some of these, not all, but half of these communities right now, it's about 28 communities like these ones. Not only you have information on who interacts with whom, but on the strength of that interaction. So in particular, what we were looking as is as the distribution of these strength values. And in particular, let's see, one way to answer your question would be that here we could see what would happen with in this kind of more detailed information in terms of the same patterns we've seen. For example, asymmetry. When you look at nestedness, there's this asymmetry of specialization that means that specialists interact with generalists, right? So in here you can look at asymmetry but from the point of view of the strength. And what you can see is pretty much the same result. So those networks are really asymmetric also when you look at the weighted data. That means that if a plant depends very much on a pollinator, the pollinator tends to depend very, very little on that plant. Also you find that that kind of description of a very heterogeneous system. For the binary data, you can plot the connectivity distribution, and you see that while the majority of species interact only with one or a few, you can find species that interact with many. So in here, you can do the same with the quantitative equivalent that is species strength. And again, the picture it emerges is, again, a very heterogeneous and asymmetric network. You are totally right.
The simulations that you showed toward the end of the presentation, that generally what they were showing was that the least generalist of some of the components were most important to network stability, and I mean, that's obviously a little bit counterintuitive, but what I'm wondering is, in those simulations, did you take phylogenetic relatedness into account? So that was my question, because I wondered that, first of all, and then the second part was, as you try to expand into social networks or economic networks, if you try to take that stuff into account, how do you do it? I'm looking at the picture of the garment industry, and I'm thinking, okay, the woman behind the one in the front might be your cousin. Mm-hmm. So you get little blocks of people work together to facilitate that sort of stuff. I mean,
Exactly.
It seems to me that to be able to deal with that, you've got to incorporate those.
Exactly. That's a very good question. There are... I think you are totally right. The answer again is we've not used that information in the simulations because that's where that come one before the other or simultaneously. But for example, now talking with going back to that question of Andy about how to incorporate trophic flexibility, one can now use that information in terms of making more realistic that trophic flexibility. For example, you can rewire the interaction of one species using that phylogenetical information. So other things being equal, you have a higher probability of being linked to a species that is phylogenetically close to the species you've been interacting with, because other things being equal, they are going to share similar traits, similar life history, and so on. So that would be a way to add this phylogenetic information into the simulations. In the context of social systems, I'm not really sure how to do that because there's no such thing as a phylogeny, but probably you can come up with a surrogate. Exactly. So probably you could try to think about a surrogate, and again see to what degree knowing that historical information can improve those simulations. I think that's a very good point.
So maybe one more question and then
Neil.
In the analysis of sensitivity of loss and related to nestedness, the literature on these mutualistic networks focus more on generality. So things that are more highly linked or that are generalized, if they're lost first, then the network is sensitive. But you're moving into nestedness. In the calculation of nestedness, so we have both generalists and specialists contributing to the ability of that pattern to exist,
right?
The asymmetry.
Right.
So do you find, is there a way to reconcile those? If you look at the species more in detail, is it that the generalists are the way that Jane Mamet would describe, are the ones that are contributing to the pattern or not? Is it you get the species that are most contributing to nestedness that are lost first, are those a bunch of rare specialists that are part of that pattern, or are they generalists? You should have more specialists in a sense contributing to nestedness than the few generalists, and so
mm-hmm.
you might get that.
Mm-hmm.
That pattern raw.
You are right. If you were analyzing the raw data, there's a strong correlation between specialization and contribution to nestedness. But the results I've been showing you before, that relationship has been taken care of, because otherwise you would be confounding the two factors. So if you are not doing that, of course, species that have the larger number of interactions tend to survive, just because they interact with more players and other things, meaning, well, they got rewards for it's a portfolio effect into ecology. You are totally right. That happens. However, when I was talking about this individual contribution, that result is after disentangling or controlling for the effect of degree. So even in that case, you find that particular result. And therefore, in this case, contribution is independent of degree. I mean, some specialists can be a higher contributor, other specialists can be a lower contributor, and the same for generality.
Okay, let's both thank Jordi, and also I forgot to mention that this is part of the Storer Lectureship Series, and that's responsible for bringing Jordi here. So thank you again.
Thanks so much.